two of them.
Salvation.
The Abrahamic law conditional.
Okay, that's it. I got it. All right, God bless everyone. We're in the book of Galatians, I do believe, and yep. It's in the, let's see what chapter.
This ain't my team, I mean. This
ain't my team. That ain't your team, now?
This ain't your count.
Oh, you done gave up on them, huh?
This ain't your count.
We're in the book of Galatians, the third chapter. We'll jump into the fourth chapter of Galatians as well. Of course, we got a lot of scriptures we want to run through to kind of make this lesson comprehensive to us. We've been talking about grace and the law. Paul said, who bewitched you, who fooled you, who put some magical spell on you that you think you should obey the law? And how did you get everything you got from Christ? Was it through faith or was it through obeying the law? So that was the question we had last week. Everything that you've gotten so far through Christ, was it through faith in Christ or was it through obeying some rules of the law? Okay. And if you think it's obeying some rules of the law, the question is, who put a magical spell on you that you are now so soon removed from faith in Christ to the law? Come on in. We got some heavyweights joining us. All right. Maybe we got no extra Bibles. Maybe somebody can push some that way or something. How you guys doing? Good, 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 good. Maybe we'll get them to share a book, two or three at a time. Got a picture? Who's the smartest? That's you.
I would have read mine.
Okay, so here's a quick question to the class. We'll throw this around. In the promise of God to Abraham, was salvation, eternal life, going to heaven, was that part of that covenant? And was that covenant, the covenant that was given to us, the Abrahamic covenant that we are in, been adopted into, is it conditional? Conditional means there's no requirement on the one who's receiving the promises. Or was it unconditional, which means that you have to meet some conditions in order for these promises to be delivered to you? So as we know that covenant, how would you respond? Was it conditional or unconditional? And does that promise that God made, that covenant, is it salvation included in that covenant?
That's why I'm be quiet over here.
So we'll have to see. Now we have to understand what a covenant is. A covenant is a contract. Man makes contracts all the time. You're in a contract if you buy a house, a car, or go to work, or what have you. This is what you would do. This is what I would do. Your boss says this is what I would do. I'll pay you every 2 weeks. This is what you would do for me to pay you every 2 weeks. That's a condition. Abraham. God made promise to Abraham. I guess we better look at it. Maybe it was going to be in, where is that covenant?
Genesis 17.
Genesis is the 17th chapter. If you have a Bible, we'll get someone in there. We'll read it. And we'll see the one who's making the promise and the one who's receiving the promise. And we'll see if there's anything that says this is what you have to do in order for this promise to become alive in your life. And Genesis 17 chapter. And verse 6. Chapter 7, verse 6. I'm going to read Genesis 17, chapter verse 1. Promise was delivered to Abraham when he was 90 years old. The Lord appeared to Abram and said unto him, I am the Almighty God. Walk before me, be thou perfect. I will make my covenant between me and thee, and will multiply thee exceedingly. Going down to verse 6. I will make thee exceedingly fruitful. I will make nations out of you. Kings shall come out of you. I will establish my covenant between me and thee and thy seed after thee in the generations for an everlasting covenant. To be a God to thee and unto your seed after you. Have we run into any conditions yet? Not yet. I mean, we see that the promise, and this is what you got to do to get the promise. I haven't seen that yet. Don't say, I will give unto thee until thou seed after thee. This is what I'm going to give you. And to your kids that come after you. The land that you are traveling in as a stranger, all the land of Canaan, for an everlasting possession, and I will be your God. All right. So, you see any salvation in there? Everlasting life in there? Do you see anything that you got to do to receive this cup? First, it was said. So basically what we have is a promise from God to a man called Abram. Changed his name later to Abraham. The guy's 90 years old. God came to him and said, this is what I'm going to do for you. Here's my promise to you and to your kids to come after you. And so what do you got to do? Believe it or don't believe it? He hasn't said nothing yet about everlasting life. Y'all wouldn't answer, of course.
I agree with that.
Okay. So it was a promise. God made a contract, an everlasting contract. He says, this is what I'm going to do. And he's talking to a nation of people called Jews, J-E-W-S, peculiar people, different kind of people than all the other people on the face of the earth. How they're different. He said, God came to that people and says, this is what I'm going to do for you. Here's my promise. Okay, now. In order to receive that promise, you've got to be a Jew. How many Jews we got? Anyone I'm talking about when I say Jew? No Jews? So, you had to be a Jew to be a descendant of Abraham. It's unconditional. It's a contract. It's like when humans make contracts. We'll flip over to our lesson in the book of Galatians today. Right? You want to pick it up? Galatians 3:15. I want to get my Bible. Someone reads Galatians 3:15 if you got it.
That's in your lesson.
That's in my lesson.
Brethren, I speak after the manner of men. Though it be but a man's covenant, yet if it be confirmed, no man disannul it or addeth thereto.
Okay. I speak after a man's covenant. Brethren, I speak after the manner. This is what a man would do. Though it's not a man's covenant. A man didn't make this up. But it is confirmed. It is agreed. In other words, it can't be changed. It is confirmed. No man can disannul, change, and add to take away, or none of that. Forever, year or two. And look, if you got the Bibles, you can go back to Genesis 46, chapter verse 1 and 4. Talking about the covenant again. Genesis 46, chapter verse 1. Genesis 46 chapter, to save some time, I'm just going to read verse 3. And he said, I am God, the God of thy father. Fear not to go down into Egypt, for I would there make thee a great nation, which is what he said earlier. I'm going to make you a great nation, and I will go down with thee into Egypt. I will also surely bring thee up again, and Joseph shall put his hand upon thine eyes. So God is confirming again. I'm going to go with you, and I'm going to make you a great nation. All right, now, we have here, what we're been talking about is that some people think that you have to, in order to be in the Abraham's covenant, that you have to earn your way into that covenant. And you hear it every day, all the time. Preachers putting conditions on the promises of God. And affirm to you, just like Paul was saying, there is no conditions to receive the blessings that's in the Abrahamic covenant other than you believe in what God said. That trips a lot of people up that God can be that good, that generous, that he can give me everything in that covenant without me earning any of it. But I mean earning, working, achieving, meriting, any of it. What's in that covenant that God promised Abraham? Because as I said earlier, it's eternal life in that covenant. We come to the conclusion, not the real fast deduction of 2,000 years and so forth, plus that eternal life is not promised in that covenant. What was promised, big deal, is that I will be your God. I will go where you go. I will multiply your children. I will make them very, very great. And give you a perfect example. Look up in the sky, Abraham. Count all those stars up there. Whoa. Look, go to the beach, Abraham, and look at the sand on the sea and count all that stuff that makes up that sand. And that's how much I'm going to bless you in everything. Money, kids, cars, houses. That's how well, that's how your seed is going to be numbered. Look at the stars, count them. Look at the sand on the sea, count it. And if you can count it all up, then you know how well I'm going to bless you. Here's the deal. Can you believe it? But no eternal life is in that covenant. Promised in that covenant. That's the shortcut to the lesson. I'll tell you that right now. Okay. But do the preachers, do the men in the Bible talk about eternal life? Well, if you go to John, St. John, the third chapter, verse 1 through verse 8, let's see. That's the study of the Bible. St. John 3, verses, chapter 3, verse 1 through 8. What do you got to say? St. John 3. This is it. Preachers preaching eternal life. There was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus. He ruled over the Jews. The same came to Jesus by night and said to him, Rabbi, we know you are a teacher come from God, for no man can do those miracles that thou do except God be with you. Jesus answered and said unto him, verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be what?
Born again.
Mystery. Born again. He cannot see the kingdom of God. Nicodemus said unto him, how can a man be what? How can I be born again when I'm old? Legitimate question, right? Can I go back inside my mother's womb and be born? Jesus said, verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born of the water and of the spirit, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God. That which is born of the flesh is flesh. That which is born of the spirit is spirit. Don't be surprised, I say to you, you must be born again. The wind blow where it desires. You hear the wind, but can't tell where it come from and where it go. So everyone that is born, so is everyone that is born of the Spirit. So it's something, so that covenant of God, the covenant of, that he gave to Abraham, it's a covenant that you can put your hand on. You can look at it. You can read it. You can actually experience it. But it will not give you what? Eternal life. It won't touch your what? Spirit. This is what your spirit. There's something in you that can be made alive to God. Abraham's covenant won't do it. So, all right. That kind of clarifies that. The other scriptures is 1 Peter 1:23, 1 John 5:1. Now, we talked about, a student over here told us they know what Jews are, and we all agree that we're not Jews. So we are kind of like of an unnatural people. I remember a couple of weeks ago, it could be like said that when they called us Gentiles in the flesh, it's kind of like throwing out that N word. Because of the lifestyle that everybody had that was not a Jew. They were just crazy, wild, unpredictable. They don't look at nobody. You act like a heathen. Well, the word heathen is just a more tame word for another adjective. We're more used to it. Untamed. You don't know what to do. Wouldn't go in that neighborhood for nothing in the world. wouldn't sit down and eat with him, went up in the book. That's how Peter was acting when, last week when Paul had to straighten him out. So now, we're unnatural. Romans 11 chapter tells you how unnatural everybody outside of the Hebrew race was considered. Romans, where's Romans? Oh, this one. Romans 11, 13. Here we go. 11:13. He says it like this. Anybody got it? How did Paul say it when he was talking to everybody outside of the Jewish nation? What did he say? Say it out loud.
Before I speak, go ahead.
Or speak to you Gentiles, inasmuch as I am the apostle of the Gentiles, I magnify my office.
So I'm speaking to you Gentiles. Not Jews, I'm speaking to you. Let me get this straight. When it comes to the everlasting Father, the God of all creation, let me tell y'all something. That's what he's getting ready to say. I'm speaking to you Gentiles. Okay, verse 15. Sister Hill.
Oh.
Will you read that?
Same chapter?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. For if the casting away of them be reconciled of the world, what shall the receiving of them be but life from the dead?
Mm-hmm. Verse 16.
For if the first fruit be holy,
which is the Jews,
the lump also holy,
right.
And if the root be holy, so are the branches.
All the Jews are holy. Verse 17.
And if some of the branches be broken off, and thou, being a wild olive tree, were grafted in among them, and with them partakest of the root and fatness of the olive tree.
Okay.
Boast not, you understand?
Mm-hmm. Go ahead, we'll read that.
Boast not against the branches, but if thou boast, thou bearest not the root, but the root thee.
He's giving an example of a tree. If a tree, you see a tree all grown up, guess what? The root is part of the tree system. The tree came from the roots. The roots is holy, so is the tree. But get the branches. Guess what? The branches is holy too. That's the nation of Israel. Those are the people of God. And God got upset with his own people, and guess what he did? He broke off the branches. And he threw the branches somewhere. Just threw them out, ready to let them go. And now, part of me, I'm still in the roots, but I'm breaking off the branches because they're not acting like me up there. Now, he says, so, since I broke off the branches of that tree, anybody ever, what do you call it, Sister Hill, when you mix plants?
Graft
a plant into another plant? Uh-huh. Like if that was a real plant, you see, I'm going to put a rose bush in there too. That's some dirt, put some water in there, they'll both grow together. And before you know it, it's going to be a rose bush, whatever else that is. So that's what God says. I'm going to find me somebody else to plug into my tree. Oh, look at those Gentiles. I'm going to take them and I'm going to plug them into my tree and give them water. Comes from the root system all the way up through the tree to the branches. And guess what? Those other branches that I just put off, they're a part of me now. But they're unnatural branches. They weren't meant to be there. I just got there because I was what? Gracious. Grace. I did it for them. They didn't do a thing. Then you got some Gentiles today running around here thinking like they earned that spot on that tree. Is that by the goodness of God, by the grace of God, got plugged in to that tree. That's what he said. Woo! Bless it all, let's go get some coffee and donuts. We're not going to take so much longer. That's how you got in to the family of God, is that he just reached out and plucked you up from your wildness, a wild branch, and plugged you into a tame tree and gave you some water, and you got grafted in. And now you know all of the stuff about the nation Israel because it's coming up from the root system. You know all of that stuff that's been going on. But you got planted in. Now the Bible goes on to say here also that don't you go bragging, because the same way that God broke off those other branches, he can also do what? Break you on it. If you don't do what? Believe the promises that he made to those other branches. Same promises. He broke them off because they didn't believe. He said, well, I'll go get somebody else. They'll believe. Plug us in. And you can get broken off if you don't believe. Okay, so now they're trying. This church was called Galatia Church. They were doing just great, these unnatural branches, until somebody came along and says, oh no, it ain't that easy. You got to start doing what is in the law. So Hebrews 10 and 1 says something about the law. We'll look at it pretty quick. Hebrews 10 and 1, running real quick. All righty. Because now the law, now we got some rules. If you want to follow, get God's promises, you got to obey these rules. Regulations. Because the law is there. You can't say Moses didn't write the law. How many heard the Ten Commandments? Everybody have? How many heard of the book of Deuteronomy? Everybody have? Everybody read it? Some of us try and induct ourselves into it and all that. So everybody God know the book of Hebrews, Deuteronomy, Leviticus, all that we try and jump into as Gentiles and make ourselves a part of the Jewish family. That's how we try and make ourselves. That's a mistake. But they did have the law. And the law was good. God gave them the law. It was good. But what was its purpose? Hebrews 10 and 1 says the law was what? Who got it?
For the law having a shadow of good things to come. Woo. And not the very image of the things that never with those sacrifices For the law having a shadow of good things to come, and not the very image of the things, can never with those sacrifices which they offered year by year continually make the comers unto perfect.
Perfect. You never get perfect with God obeying a set of rules, regulations. Never will become perfected with God. Good enough to make it, walk the streets of gold, go through the pearly gates, sit down with Paul, Peter, and all, and sing your song when I get to heaven. That's what you don't sing. That's what songs people sing. When I get to heaven, pie in the sky, and divine. This is what I'm going to do. So I've got to obey all these rules so I can get there. All right, here we go. So, God said the shadow of things to come. Now let's listen to our lesson today, back to the book of Galatians. Brethren, I speak after the manner of men, though it be a man's covenant, like a man's covenant, yet it be confirmed, no man disannulled by it a guarantee. Now to Abraham and his seed were the promises made. The promises was made to Abraham and his seed, all those Jews. He said not as to seeds, as of many, but as of one, and to thy seed, which is Christ. So it says everything is going to come through your seed, not seeds, seed. That seed, if they were bright enough to know, that seed means there's a particular seed that all of the promises are going to be opened up to the rest of the world. And that seed is Christ. That's what he's saying there real quick. Verse 17, I say this, that the covenant, the promises, I'm on verse 17 now, I say this, that the covenant that was confirmed before God in Christ, the law, which was 430 years after God made the promise, does not change the promise. That's what he says, cannot disannul. First God made the promise, and then 430 years later come this guy called Moses. Moses says, I'm going up to the top of the mountain here, I'm going to come down with some set of rules, y'all wait right here till I get back, and be good folks till I get back. Could they even do that?
Yep.
Couldn't even be good folks. They made a golden calf and had a party and had it going on while Moses was up there 30, 40, how many 40, days?
40.
40 days up there on the mountain. Not even eating and drinking, just sitting down, listening to God and writing down the law. He says, y'all be good till I get back. He come back and they had it going on. Whew. He got so mad, he did what? Threw the whole thing down. I said, okay, Moses, come right back up here.
Well, all
don't even stop getting there to eat. Getting right back up
there.
Yeah. Yeah. So, and that's how people are, because that those rules and everything that Moses is bringing down from the top of the mountain can't change the people's what?
Hearts. That's right.
Yeah. written stuff can't change your heart. It's got to be an invisible turnover on the inside. Okay, so that's what he says. 400 years later, in verse 17, here come what Moses did, but God had a promise 430 years before. What Moses did does not affect the promises that I made. It's that it should make the promises a non-effect. Verse 18, and we're talking about an inheritance. When we talk about Abrahamic covenant, the blessings of Abraham, we're talking about an inheritance. Like when I die, my kids get my broke bank account. Entitled to it. My old beat up car. Fully entitled to it. My suits. My son can have all my suits. Shoes. I'll be going up there in heaven having a good time. You can have everything. You're entitled to it. So the inheritance. So now we're talking about an inheritance from a very real person called Abraham. Abraham was poor or rich?
Very rich.
Very rich.
Abraham was very, very rich. When he left out of here, he left all of that behind. God says, you got kids, so many kids that they outnumber the stars. So they're entitled to your stuff, Abraham. But Abraham said, okay, they can have it. Now, we're talking about an inheritance. If the inheritance is to you because of rules and regulations, it is no more a promise. I'm promising my kids they can have all my broke bank accounts, holes of shoes in them, dog. It's all yours, I promise it to you. No rules, just all yours. And that's what an inheritance is. Now, God gave it to Abraham by what? Promise. Anything your kids can do, Sister Hill, to get outside of your will?
No.
Become bad actors?
No.
They're still entitled to it. Still her kids. Like one of them go to church with me. But no. Still her kids. She's still up. They're entitled to it. And that's how God is with us. You're entitled. So what's my blessings? Blessings of Abraham. Wealth, prosperity, peace. All the good stuff that you can imagine on earth, God has promised it to the children of Abraham. The problem is that the question is, if I'm a Gentile, how do I get to be a Jew so I can get in on those promises of Abraham and receive them just by believing that God said so? How many think that you are a Gentile? You know, God, look at your hair.
You're so awesome.
Brother John, you better edit that.
You can do a bleach job all you want. I can tell. It's your time. So, how do I get in on those promises of Abraham? While I'm here on the earth, I want to live like one of Abraham's kings. Alright. Well, we're going to run into the fourth chapter of Galatians. First, we're going to make sure we identify who's the rightful heirs, who's the rightful recipients. So we're going to read verse 4 and verse 2, if you will, please. I mean, chapter 4, chapter of verses 1 and 2.
Now I say that the heir, as long as he is a child, differs nothing from a servant, though he be Lord of all, but is under tutors and governors until the time appointed of the Father.
Okay. An heir is he's just a kid, he don't know nothing, so he's got to have a babysitter, a nanny, or somebody over him until he becomes of age. Most of you don't become an adult in American society until you're about what?
18,
you can call your own shots, fix your own food, cook your own meals, buy your own house, get your own car, do whatever you want to do. There, I suspect.
Except the males have to be 21.
If you're a man, 21. No figure. A woman must have made that rule. But here you go. 18, can't do nothing, man, girl, it's all yours. So, what can I say? Because they say girls are smarter than boys, so they're ready to take on the world at 18.
More mature.
Boys are not ready until 21. It takes them a few years longer.
I'm still not ready at 21.
They don't know how to. They're just not ready.
A whole lot of hate going on.
I know. So they gotta have somebody over, watch over them, teach them, show them. That's what a governor and tutor. That's what it is. A tutor teaching them how to get ready for life. Then he says, "Now you're ready for life. Although you are entitled to everything that your father Abraham has promised you, you are 100% entitled to it from the time you was born. But you can't handle it because you don't know nothing." So therefore, we got to have somebody teaching you and working with you until you get of age. That's what a tutor was. Now, even so we, and go to Galatians 5 and 1. Because this is what will happen if you get the stuff too early. If you get that boat, that car, and all that money and all that, that's for sure. Kind of like somebody that we saw on the TV all day yesterday. I got what? How many heard of that lady? How many know about Whitney Houston? You guys know anything about her? Can she sing?
Oh, yeah.
No? Anybody else? Y'all can sing maybe? Not yet. She's pretty. Fine as she can be. Had it all. Let's open the mouth, make millions. Name me a song, I'll sing it. Blessings of Abraham was far. More than enough. But if you get the stuff and you ain't ready for it, you're still a kid. But you can get trapped. This is what happened to you. Galatians 5 and 1. What does it say?
Stand fast, therefore, in the liberty wherewith Christ hath made us free, and be not entangled again with the yoke of bondage.
Okay. So, and then verse 2, he's talking about trying to merit, trying to work, trying to deserve the stuff that your Heavenly Father has promised you through inheritance. You're trying to work for it. I say unto you, that if you be circumcised, if you do that stuff that's in the law, Christ profits you what?
Nothing.
You have no gain. You trying, now that you have confessed faith in Jesus Christ and you're trying to work out, you're trying to work it and merit it and deserve it and all that kind of stuff, Christ was no good to you whatsoever. You're Gentiles. And somebody was telling this small church the other day, not only do you have to believe in Christ, but you got to follow the laws of Moses. You got to get into those first five books of the Bible so you can understand your do's and don'ts. Verse 4, Christ has become no effect unto you. Whosoever of you justified how by the law you have fallen from grace. Just having God do stuff for you. You know it's going. That's God's doing. That's God's doing. You wake up every morning. I'm looking for God to do something for me today. Grace. God, I expect you to get something done for me. Grace. I'm just a spoiled child. I don't know how to be poor. I'm not familiar with sickness. All that stuff is strange to me. You know, how many ever met somebody that's rich, rich kid? Mm-hmm. Be around people that's rich. Candy was talking about her niece that when she used to go to school on the other side of town. A friend of Jessica's on the other side of town, when they would take their lunch money and put it on the desk and go play and stuff, they'd come back, lunch money's still there. But then they had transferred to Northside schools. And they would leave their money in their coat on the lunch pail on the desk, and they'd come back and it was always gone. So I had to learn a tough lesson. That you don't do that in certain parts of in certain neighborhoods because you know, it's a rich neighborhood, people got everything, they're not after your stuff. I mean, money laying around, no big deal. It's always money available. Over here, Rick, the North Side neighborhood, money is coveted. Your stuff is coveted. So rich folks don't deal like that. They don't have that type of mentality. Now, I'm not used to being poor, broke, sick, disgusted, all like that. It's just part of my living because I have inherited that stuff from my father way. It's just part of it. Okay, now, so we, verse 3 of our lesson, Galatians 4:3, so we, when we were children, we were born in bondage under the elements of the world. And then you had stuff, life was against you. It's contrary, it's coming after you. And, you know, I mean, it's the elements of the world, in other words, the dictates of everything that's contrary to you being happy is coming after you. And I hate to keep using that example that we saw on TV yesterday, but as soon as she stepped out there into the big lights, instead of peace, happiness, love, achievement, and all that sophistication coming after her, the elements of the world is coming after her. Coming after your money. Coming after your health. Coming after everything that you got. I'm coming to take it away from you, and I'm going to leave you disgusted and embarrassed, even in death. They're going to find you 100% exposed to the world, naked in a bath, dead, full of my elements that I got, full of my bondage. That's how the world is going to find you, because I'm coming at you. You don't believe the world is coming after you, you got to trick my head. So here's what you got to do. You got to say, I identify with the family of God, which is a blessed family, and I'm just blessed because I believe what God promised me through his covenant contract word. And I ain't working for a dime. I ain't trying to get up in the morning and achieve anything. It just happens because I believe. Okay, lesson in a nutshell. That's what that was, okay. But Wasn't always like that. When the verse 4 of our lesson of chapter 4, when the fullness of the what? Time was come. That's a trick word. What's up with that? God sent forth his son, made of a what? Made under the law. Now this is mystery. And that the first clue of that mystery is in the book of Genesis, the 3rd chapter, verse 16. There's any scripture in the Bible that a person should know. He should, that's one of them. Some of us know John 3:16. Y'all know what John 3:16 is? God so what? How about Genesis 3:16?
Gotcha.
Someone read it. Anybody got it? I could be wrong.
Unto the woman he said,
okay.
I will greatly multiply thy sorrow and thy conception. In sorrow thou shalt bring forth children, and thy desire shall be to thy husband, and he shall rule over thee.
So when you get married, girls, your husband going to be lost. You got that? Jessica wasn't in though. Okay. Genesis 3:15. What does that say?
We messing with you, baby.
And I will put enmity between thee and the woman, and between thy seed and her seed.
Okay.
It shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise his heel.
Okay, I don't know if the kid's into biology yet, but it says, I will put enmity. That's the first clue right there. We should know that as good as we know John 3:16. That there is a mystery unfolded, and it unfolds in God's time, and that mystery keeps on unfolding, keeps on getting clearer and clearer as time goes on, what God meant right there. And that her seed is the first clue. Woman does not have a what?
Seed.
Seed comes from man. But God didn't make a mistake. Her seed. Wow, mercy. Isaiah 9. It's the mystery of her seed keeps unfolding throughout the Bible. It could be 9 and 6. Where is it? Was that Isaiah 12 or what? Behold, a virgin.
Isaiah 9 and 6.
Yeah. What do you got?
Sons. That's Isaiah 9
and 6. Isaiah 9 and 6. For unto us a son is given, the government should be upon his shoulder, his name should be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. Who in the world could that be?
Jesus.
Jesus Christ. And the first chapter of the book of Luke talks to you about a virgin